thanking Nathan Hale for providing me with this excellent chance to present a little bit my, it's not really even work, my work in progress, before an audience with such an erudition, which I can only dream of. And so today, as you know, I have been working on the problem of grades in Tangut for a moment. And so today, I'll just pick up where I left off back in Hamburg, where because I didn't treat the thing about the grade 2. And so today I'll talk about it, and I'll be also talking a little bit about Chinese also. So I call Hexi late middle Chinese the Chinese dialect that is spoken by Tangut and the Chinese dialect that the Tangut learn Chinese from. So let's start with some basic information. The most interesting to me category, phonological category in Tangut is the start of grades. So by Gonghuang Cheng, usually we reconstruct three grades for a Tangut by on the basis of a conjunction of rhyme ordering in dictionaries. So in dictionaries like the Wenhai or the C characters, and we have other lexicographic materials that present the exactly the same ordering of rhyme categories. So it's something that is very much agreed upon by the Tangut philologists themselves. And the other thing is the Tangut Chinese transcription evidence. There is a slight asymmetry between the Chinese to Tangut side and the Tangut to Chinese side, but for the great problem, it's okay. So, as an example, we take the rhymes R34, R34 to R37, and we see that the first rhyme in this group transcribes almost only Chinese syllables in the Chinese grade 1, and the second rhyme in this group, 35, transcribes only Chinese characters of the grade 2, and the remaining two rhymes, 36 and 37, more or less indiscriminately transcribes Chinese grades 3 and 4. In fact, these two are in near complementary distribution, and if we look really hard at the near part, we see that they are usually artificial, and we can for most of these groups like this, we can make a case for real complementary distribution. So I agree with Gonghuang Cheng in reconstructing only three grades. So the traditional reconstruction of the value of the grades is made by Sofronoff as a mirror image of the Chinese reconstruction at his day. So he considered the grade thing basically a thing of medials. So the first grade has no medials, the second grade has some kind of weak yod, and the third grade has some kind of strong yod. This is carried over adverbum by Gonghuang Cheng. So you have the несколько слабее йода represented by a vocalic e in Gonghuang Cheng's reconstruction, and the stronger yod represented by a real yod. This creates the problem that it's very difficult to pronounce ea and ye. What's the difference between ba and ye? I can pronounce a lot of things, but this one is a little bit difficult. So Peng Huangcheng made a decision he basically invented an allophony, where in grade three it's the vowel is slightly raised, so you have a, ye, and ye. What is pronounceable, a little bit pronounceable, and but sadly it is not supported by the transcription evidence. So my favorite example is just the basic mantra in Mahayana Buddhism, Om Mani Padme Hum. And if we look at the usual reconstruction, we have Om Yani Byamye Hum. And so clearly it doesn't work, and it needs to be updated. And I have the chutzpah to consider the updating basically done. At the moment, let's start with a little bit of context. So Tangut, it is known already at the time of Wolfenden and Wang Xingru that Tangut is a Changic language, closely related to languages like Qiang, to Minyak, to Garangic languages. But at this time, those languages are not very well described. So basically, in order to be able to do the nice kind of comparison, you need really do great dictionaries of those languages, and you thousands of words before you can really get to something. So now with Guillaume Jacques, who has worked for more than a decade on Japuk, he has a very great dictionary of Japuk, and he has looked for all the possible cognates, and he found some 300 of them. So we have something very solid to work on, which is the cognates between Tangut and Japuk Garang. So based on a comparison with Japuk Garang, which I will not explain today, I'll gladly redo the presentation I have done in Hamburg and elsewhere if you want it. And so what I suggest is that there is a phonological distinction of uvularization, so between uvularized vowels, which are pronounced like ba, ba, and non-uvularized plain vowels, which are pronounced ba, ba. So the distinction between grade one and grade three, which were reconstructed before as ba versus bia, is now reconstructed as ba versus ba. This distinction of uvularization triggers an allophony for the velar, so basically the ya yin initials between a and ga. It is very clear that grade two is uvularized as grade one. But we don't know what the thing distinguishes grade two from grade one. So for now, I'll write an R for grade two, and we'll have a look in detail. So where does the uvularization in Garangic come from? Well, the first origin is what I call the primary uvularization. It must be reconstructed back to Proto-Changic, and it has some correspondences within among other Sino-Tibetan languages, but it's too early to say anything serious about it. However, if we just look at Changic languages, the thing is quite clear. So, for example, for Pers Nong, it's ball uvularized Tangut, and in Zbu Garong, the language I'm working on, is Das Wu, with a velarized or uvularized vowel, which I call emphatic vowel. And we have the same thing in Minyan, the language which shares the name of Tangut. It's ba ba. So for willow, it's uralized in Tangut, and it's emphatic in Zbu, etc., etc. We also have what, so this is the primary uralization, which is inherited from Proto-Changic. We also have secondary uralization. So the basically the root wasn't uralized at the stage of Proto-Changic, but now there are other things which went to the syllable and which makes it uralized. So for example, if we have a uvular coda, so for example to weave, which is da in Japu, da, there's the h, and this h goes to the syllable, and so we have not la but la la. For snake, it is the same g, but in the first position. So basically, we should have po or something for snake, but it's po, and this r, this uvular element goes onto the syllable and makes it po po. And not only uvulars, but velar elements, basically velar codas, and n, which I hypothesize as having turned into some kind of nasalized w, then to this g. And these also make secondary uvularizations. So what do we find here? We find the ubiquitous pattern, the basic conspiracy in the historical phonology of Tangut, which Mark Miyake describes as compression. I have changed his definition a little bit. And for me, what is compression? Compression is that materials, phonological or phonetic materials around the syllables. So for example, the codas or pre-initials, or even some kind of minor syllables, they all went to the main part of the syllable and become some kind of pan-syllabic feature, which works for the syllable as a whole. That is, for example, how we usually explain the origin of retroflexes in Tangut. So you have pre-initial R or coda R, which just extends to the syllable as a whole, and itself it has disappeared. So this is the compression, and so the uvularization in Tangut fits very well into this great picture of compression. So we have left the grade two unexplained. It has something to do with R, so I rewrite it as a R in capital letters. But what is it? First, we'll look at the transcription evidence for this great R. For the Chinese transcription, there isn't much to be said. First, it transcribes a grade 2. Second, it transcribes a grade 3 with zhuangzu shengmu, so with a retroflex fricative or affricate as the initial. The Tibetan transcription is more interesting. I think it's for the han B and han D, am I right? Where we have the vowel A in the second, in grade 2, transcribed as R. So for example, this character, which is Ba, is transcribed as Ba. And this is, and you never find the grade 1 syllable in comparable circumstances transcribed with an R. Well, that's all we have got for the transcription material, so it's quite hard to interpret. It's more interesting to consider the etymological origins of the grade 2 capital R. So the first origin of the grade 2 capital R is uvularization plus medial R. So for example, if you have ka without the R in Japuk, you will have ka in first in grade 1 in Tangut. But in fact, because there is an R, it's ka, so the R is reflected as the grade 2. Also, for willow, it's zimbri or zimbr, and it is duly reflected as boyo with this capital R. For white, here the uvularization is not primary but comes from the coda M. However, because there is the R, so coda M brings uvularization, and uvularization plus medial R brings second degree, brings grade 2. The same medial R in non-uvularized context just disappears. So, for example, this is a word which is shared by almost every Changic language, so it's quite useful. Gr or gru, which means sinew, redondant, and there is an R, but it has disappeared because it's not uvularized. So the same thing for clear water, which is angri and just gi. There is no difference between gi and gri. So that was the first origin for the second degree for grade 2 in Tangut. And now things get more interesting. Here we have the R, which has an uvular initial with the vowels E, A, and U. So basically, if any of you speak a language with uvulars, you know that it's very difficult to pronounce ti. It's almost impossible to do p with a normal E. So there is always some kind of intervening transitional element between uvular initial and high vowel or a front vowel. And however, in Tangut, this thing is categorized as the same thing as the other origins of grade 2. That is why I think that Miyake's hypothesis that 104 and 204 are grade 2 rhymes and not grade 1 rhymes is correct, because basically you have other initials in 101 and 201, but you have almost only velar, in fact uvular initials in 102 and 104 and 204. So the R thing here is some kind of transitional element which has a low vowel. In one of the Garangic languages, which is a cross variety of cross-calf spoken in Wolfzi, we have the same thing. So for difficult, which is nta, you have narai, narai, narai. However, a normal word with a in Japuk is just reflected as E in cross-calf and E grade 3 E in Tangut, Jvi and Narai. And why we have this Narai is because it's difficult to say Nari, Nari. If you say Nari and you don't pay very much attention, it becomes Narai. The last origin for the second for the grade 2 in Tangut is retroflex initials. I think I don't have the time to explain it clearly here. So I've just declared by fiat that the shibboleths, so the Zhangzu initials are pronounced retroflex before a uvularized rhyme. So what does this say? It means that because shibboleths are only compatible with grade 2 but not grade 1. It means that the capital R is some kind of transitional element between a retroflex sound and a vowel and any vowel. So for those of you who would love to look at a little bit at the argument, I leave it here. And let's go to the summing up. So in order to recapitulate the evidence about the capital R, so what does the capital R feel like? First, there is some kind of throatiness or backness because it is only in uvularized contexts, and it's a transitional vowel between a uvular and a high or a front vowel. So it must be something like ah or aw or ah or something like that. That's our first intuition. The second intuition is that the sound has an R-like character. So otherwise it's impossible to explain the R in the Tibetan transcription. And it will be difficult to explain the origins with R and with retroflexes. However, we also know that it's not a real R because first we have the medial R in Tibetan and it's never transcribed as a medial R in Tibetan. Also, it's in the mantras. If there is a word like pra, and it will never be, and you never find a grade 2 character used to transcribe pra. In fact, you have a very, very few grade 2 characters in mantras. Basically, it's used to transcribe the long vowel a and nothing else. And thirdly, if it's really r, it's impossible to explain why becomes gri. No, it's not okay. Gri becomes dai, that's okay. Gri becomes gri, it's strange. So what do I feel about it? Well, I think that it's I call it the Ein hypothesis because I think it is an Ein. So phonologically, I will call it a pharyngeal, and phonetically, it's the vocalic correspondent of I, which is the A and very pharyngealized. So, for example, white is pronounced pow, pow. Difficult is pronounced gai, gai. And to cross the river is pronounced da, da. That's what I think. And why do I think so? Well, first, it satisfies the throatiness because you really can't get more throaty than the I. It's almost the most throaty consonant available. And it also accounts for the R-like character. This subject is curiously little treated in the literature, but if you ask anybody who works on Caucasian languages or on Arabic, and you ask them what do they think, for example, in American English and in Mandarin Chinese, you have this kind of rhotic vowels, and they will tell you that they are not vertical. The principal acoustic and articulatory element in those vowels is the pharyngeal constriction. And we find everywhere this kind of affinity between roticness and pharyngeal constriction. For example, in the Chinese transcription of Arabic, if you have an I, then it's rendered with one of the rhotic vowels in Chinese. And that's my theory about that's my current theory about the grade 2 in Tangut. And let's just project it back to Hexi late Middle Chinese. Well, it means that a grade 2 has some kind of RTR quality and it has a pharyngeal medial. So my hypothesis is that the iron hypothesis is not only true for Tangut, but it also works at least for Hexi late Middle Chinese. Now the question is this. Is this grade 2 iron in Hexi Chinese influenced or co-evolved or anything like that by Tangut? Or it's more widespread in Chinese, and in fact the Tangut is influenced by the Chinese? Well, on the nature of grade 2 in Chinese, basically we have two theories, the A theory and the U theory. The A theory is almost correct because if you look at modern dialects and if you look at all kinds of information, it's clearly something like A. However, how do you get from Ra? How do you get from Ra to A? It's very difficult. On the other hand, if we use this iron hypothesis, and so if Chinese grade 2 is characterized by a strong pharyngealization, then it's very natural to have the vowel A, which is in fact the pharyngealized counterpart of A, associated with grade 2. The other thing is that we have this association between retroflex initials and A in Tangut, and it's also very predictable to Chinese because not only in Hexi Middle Chinese, but also in the early Northern Mandarin, contemporary to Hexi Middle Middle Chinese, we have the same thing. So we have the whenever you have a retroflex, a fricative or affricate in grade 3 syllables, it is classified together with grade 2. So not only original grade 2 is grade 2, but in late Middle Chinese or in early Mandarin, or in fact in most kind of Chinese, retroflex plus everything gives grade 2. And we still have some modern reflection of this in dialects from standard Mandarin to Sino-Vietnamese. Every time, if you the original retroflexes cause a lowering of the vowel. I just put Cantonese here, but it works for any other for most other languages as well. So. I have argued for the iron as the true nature of grade 2 in Tangut, and I project it into Chinese, but it's not, in fact, it turns out that it's not dialectal Chinese, but very common Chinese, and the only thing it gives us is that the Tangut treatment of uralized r into this kind of iron is borrowed from Chinese. Why do I say it? Because in modern Changic languages, you never find this treatment, this particular treatment. It's either preserved or lost without any trace, or become some kind of real syllabic roticity, or it triggers the particular Tibetan sound change, which brings gr to zh, So for example, for the word signing, you have ger in northern ma in Beipu Qiangyu, northern ma, which is the syllabic vorticity treatment, and we have the Tibetan treatment zhi in southern ma. And this if you look at the dialect map, the treatment are really scattered. So it means that in most of the Urheimat of Changik, the medial R is preserved to a very late date. So the most plausible scenario is that all kinds of Chinese always had some kind of ain for grade two, and Tangut has borrowed it from has developed it under the influence from Chinese. So we're in our final slide. Can we speak of a Hexi Sprachbund? I got interested in the ain question first because I thought it would bring to some very clear aerial thing. So Hexi Chinese is influenced by Tangut and Tangut is influenced by Hexi Chinese. However, I think Tangut is very strongly reshaped, restricted by Hexi Chinese. However, Hexi Chinese is just some very generic kind of Northwestern Chinese. Even if the strange thing is this. The only way we can know anything about Hexi Middle Chinese is by Tangut transcriptions. And if we just read if we just listen to Tangut speaking very heavily Tangut accented Chinese, it just sounds like normal Chinese without any Tangut accent. What does that mean? It means that Tangut is so much reshaped by Chinese so that the phonological systems are almost completely compatible. You have the same kind of thing, for example, in Amdo, where you have Mongolic languages with synthetic phonology. So those people, if they speak Chinese, they just speak it like normal Chinese, etc. However, we also know that, for example, for the compression, for all kinds of compression, the dialect used, the Tibetan dialect used to transcribe the Tangut have shared the same sound changes. So I think we have a typical situation, which I call the Ottoman Balkan situation. You have the Balkan Sprachbund, where Balkan languages coexist in some kind of Pax Ottomanica, and they influence each other, and they are all influenced by Turkish, but Turkish is barely influenced by Balkan languages, and I think we have the same thing. So Tangut and local Tibetan influence each other. They're all influenced by Chinese, but Chinese is not very much influenced by Tangut. And that's all I have to say. Thank you very much.